Another trend that was a very important one and came clear during our discussions was the increased number of initiatives and programs related to water capacity development and really innovative ways of doing capacity development. And that gives us the hope that scaling up will be the next step. Also clearly came out of the discussions that we have more multi-stakeholder, multidisciplinary platforms and dialogues that are taking place more frequently, more than ever. And I think this is a wonderful trend when we are discussing water. We also felt that it would be interesting to discuss and to summarize some of the key principles or guiding principles that for us are important and should underpin education, knowledge, and capacity development initiatives. The first one is that we really need to quantity, quality, equality, and accessibility of data and information that is relevant for policy making, for capacity development, and education at all levels. It was a feeling that we are losing data, we are gathering less data, less information, we are not sharing enough, and this guiding principle should really underpin all the interventions that we do. We also feel that we should strive to have female professionals and stakeholders as full partners. One aspect of our session was really that we had parity, I would say, in the interventions, both on the keynotes, on the panel members, and we want to see that all over. And I think this is an important guiding principle when we look to education, knowledge, and capacity development initiatives. We also feel that education, knowledge, and capacity development should be seen as a means to transform mentalities, lifestyles, attitudes, behaviors, not really as a goal as such. And therefore, should this idea, this guiding principle should permeate all our programs. It also should reinforce the values and principles that underpin integrated water management approaches. We also should look for innovative and non-traditional means of communication and dissemination for capacity development. And the last but not the least guiding principle is the importance of scaling up successful initiatives and programs, and that we should accept the long-term nature of capacity development programs. And we feel that we are still too fragmented. A lot is happening, very interesting things are happening, but not fast enough and not covering enough. As recommendations, we feel that efforts should be focused on changing attitudes. Water should be seen as a crucial part of development. It is the underlying principles in all interventions. More funding sources and alliances need to be explored. Water should be part of the general education curriculum. Focus should be action-oriented education, particularly targeting children and youth. International initiatives such as the UN Decade for Education for Sustainable Development, the UN Decade for Water, they should promote water education. You know, it should be part of their mandate, should be their responsibility to make sure that national curricula, national policies, education ministries, water ministries are involved in really scaling up capacity development in water. Database of high quality should be systematized in a way that can be used in different levels, not primary, secondary, research, higher education, policy making. We can't educate well if we don't have good information and good knowledge. And this is very important. Also, we feel that we should set up a monitoring systems to check quality of data and also on the education materials to ensure objectivity and clarity. And also tailored those materials to the needs of the local stakeholders. This we felt also was a very important recommendation. We also think that we should carry out local needs assessment for capacity development prior to any major capacity development interventions. This way we can focus on the needs, we can respond to the needs of the stakeholders and of the region, of the local areas where we are working. We feel that more focus should be put in action-oriented research that includes local stakeholders, in particular communities. We should encourage science-based policy formulation. It was a huge discussion and then I think a strong conclusion that a lot of the policies don't take scientific data, research seriously when they are developed, much less when they are implemented and when their impacts are being evaluated. We also would like to encourage a holistic approach to research programs, bridging multidisciplinarity, multi-stakeholders and intersectorial approaches to the issues. We still feel that a lot of the research is done in silos. We need to be more integrated, not only in terms of sectorial approaches, but also multi-stakeholders and also multidisciplinarity. And also to improve, I think this is the last one recommendation, is that we need to improve the understanding about learning cultures and styles through multi-stakeholder platforms at various scales. The way we learn, the way capacity development is built and construct over time, it has to do a lot with culture. Our hands are all very different, and therefore it's very important to understand this. As follow-up actions, it was a commitment for all the organizations and the people that participate in these sessions that the various actors presented have made this commitment to take the findings discussed here to different conferences that will be happening this year: Conference on Education for Sustainable Development in Bonn, Stockholm Water Week, Commission for Sustainable Development in New York, and we will continue to talk and to collaborate so that new initiatives can come up and we can scale up existing initiatives. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Lydia. Connected to the educational topic, I think we have to involve those who are impacted the most, the students, the youth. So we have invited the representative of the youth organization to take the floor. Aras, please come up. Because they are going to share with us their thinking about the educational needs and how educational systems are reformed.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator, the most esteemed guests, and the most distinguished experts. Wow, look at the group, look at the audience, participants and policymakers from all over the world. It's such a great feeling to be here in front of such a diverse group. It is my pleasure to be here today. My apologies if my voice comes and goes, because I was among those people who were, those young people who were in the bridge and all over the conference venue, doing the wave, showing their participation in this forum. So I'm ill, but I will try my best to present the youth forum's opinions in this theme. Well, I have to first of all congratulate everybody who was in the youth forum. They worked night and day to come up with the youth declaration. They worked really hard. And we worked day and night to organize activities, discuss the themes, and producing the youth declaration. As I said, I'm here to convey the Youth Forum's perspective on education. These points have been set forth, discussed, and agreed upon by many young enthusiasts in long and fruitful debate. And I'm honored and privileged again to represent my colleagues in front of you today. During our discussions, it became apparent just how intermingled education was with all the other themes of the forum. Therefore, the discussions were even longer, and points reached from MDGs to public participation. The general idea of the Youth Forum was to voice our demands and to be heard and to be recognized. We may lack experience, but have the drive and enthusiasm to make a positive impact on water-related issues. And in order to do that, however, we need and to augment our abilities, education is crucial. Thus, the Youth Forum came up with suggestions and points to lobby for and to present to you in the thematic session today.